Sunday on Durban's Golden Mile. It's not long since these beaches were for whites only. In the new South Africa, they're open to all. Durban is the largest city in what's now called the province of KwaZulu-Natal. Rapid development means there's little left of the old colonial Durban today. But with the largest Indian population of any city in Africa, I found the street life has a genuine multiracial feel. A few years ago, this is the last country on earth I'd have chosen to visit. I'm one of the sanctions generation. I still feel guilty when I buy Cape fruit. But now apartheid is officially over, and I wanted to see for myself if this former forbidden zone could turn out to be the new dream destination. I've come to see a new venture in tourism, 200 miles north of Durban, near South Africa's border with Mozambique. This used to be one of the so-called homelands for Zulus, an area of low rainfall, useless for growing all but a few crops, where many still depend on subsistence cattle farming.
No roads, very limited schooling, very limited healthcare clinics and so on. It really is an incredibly rural and totally underdeveloped area. It's been a backwater for development through the old apartheid regime, and there aren't enough voters for the new government to pay attention to it in the short term.
Les Carlisle works for the Conservation Corporation. They believe it's carefully planned, high-quality tourism that offers real hope. The aim, to turn over 1,000 square miles of bush and wetland into a vast wildlife reserve, bringing jobs and income to local people. They've already started in a big way. The result is Pinda, a wildlife haven opened 3 years ago. In Zulu, Pinda means return, and that's exactly what's happening. Scores of animals have been reintroduced to the bush. Others, including 400 species of bird, were already here. South Africa has older, better known game parks than this, but there are good reasons for choosing to spend your money here. Pinda provides 250 jobs for local people, and they reckon that income supports several thousand more in the surrounding villages. The lodges and rooms were all built by villagers, and if you think Africa means uncivilized bush, think again.
Thanks, Cyril. Thanks very much.
This is five-star PC luxury. Most visitors come to Pinda for 2 or 3 days. My tracker was Chris, my ranger Rory, and they were assigned to me for the whole of my stay.
Straight over the next bank, all right, and there's almost two together.
I can see it.
Okay, the second bank furthest past there.
I can see
it. You can see the crocodile with the head up. We find this time of day, they're coming out being cold-blooded animals. They need sun to warm them. Just hang on, it's pretty steep down here.
But at Pinda, you don't just view animals from a distance. Chris has found fresh elephant tracks. The plan is to try and find them on foot.
Okay, you can see where they've come through from that side. Into this block over here, you can see where they've flattened the grass as they've walked.
What's Chris doing now?
He's trying to get upwind of them so that they're not...
They won't smell him.
They won't smell him. It sounds like they're in about 50-100 metres in. I'm going to have to go with him now. So that I've given him the backup with a rifle, OK? Otherwise, it's not fair on him, OK? Otherwise, just now he gets chased in there. He's got no support. Okay.
Don't worry about me, I'll be fine.
Don't Don't leave without me.
I cunningly camouflaged myself as a Land Rover while they checked the safest route in. Finally, I got the all clear to join them. In the African winter, elephants tend to hide themselves away in thick bush. The thrill of getting this close to them in their natural habitat is unbeatable. From Pinda, it's a 15-minute plane ride to another extraordinary adventure, the Indian Ocean, and a beach that makes the Bounty advert look like it was shot in Peckham. Here, the intrepid dive to the only coral reef off the coast of South Africa. But I settled for a little light snorkeling with Rory closer to shore. I found the Pinda experience unique, and it's no surprise that visitors are on the increase. With 90% of the staff drawn from local communities, this place surely deserves to go from strength to strength in the new South Africa. Amid hope for the future, there are still reminders of the past in Natal. ...150 miles inland from Durban are the battlefields where the British and the Boers fought over this stunningly beautiful Zulu land over a century ago. Here you'll find places like Ladysmith, Sandalwana and Rorke's Drift, immortalised by Michael Caine and a lot of extras in the oft-repeated film Zulu. South Africa has come a long way since its colonial battles of the 19th century, but that's nothing compared with the distance it's travelled since Nelson Mandela walked free from his prison just 4 years ago. For many, tourism may be the only development to help close the economic gap that still exists between black and white. And it can't be long before South Africa becomes one of the world's leading holiday destinations. As visitors, we've a lot to offer a country that's trying its best to start all over again. And one day, I'll be back.
Since the end of sanctions, the price of getting to South Africa has fallen dramatically. And with the South African summer just approaching, now is a good time to book. Illustrious neighbours of Venice and Florence, and the coastal resort of Rimini is only an hour away. This is one city where you can pretend to be Italian and almost get away with it.
It's easy to romanticise the Italians. What's harder is to visit Italy and feel like one of them instead of one of us. But in Bologna, as yet one of Italy's undiscovered cities, you can enjoy the culture and avoid the tourists. It's the city of La Dotta, La Grassa e La Rossa. La Dotta, the learned for its university, La Grassa, the fat for its food, and La Rossa, the red for its buildings and its politics. Get to grips with these three, and you've got to the heart of the place. My first task is to get to grips with the weather. Fortunately, one of Bologna's distinctive features is its 25 miles of arcades which run alongside the city's streets. It's possible to spend almost an entire day undercover. Originally built in the Middle Ages so the houses could extend over the road and provide extra accommodation for the thousands of students, they're also very useful in a shower. Another defining characteristic of Bologna is its abundance of towers built by medieval families as a sign of wealth and power. To get a bearing on Bologna, it's best to go straight to the top, the Asinelli. It's 328 feet.
Well, 498 steps, and in spite of the rain, this really is the best place to see just how the city fits together.
It's one of the most well-preserved in Europe. Take the Church of San Domenico, built in 1251 to house the relics of St. Dominic, founder of the monastic order. Ask a monk to open the gate, and a look around the back of the tomb will reveal what's believed to be one of Michelangelo's earliest self-portraits, sculpted when he was just 18. Visitors have to work harder in Bologna, but finds like this are the reward. And then there's Bologna's top delicatessen, tamburini.
100 years ago, a former student from the university here in Bologna wrote the first ever Italian cookery book, The Science of Cooking and the Art of Good Eating. And in places like this, it's easy to see how in the city known as La Grassa, or the fat, food has been elevated to both a science and an art form.
The Bolognese are proud of the pasta they invented, tortellini.
Why is it this shape?
Apparently, a chef saw a painting of a beautiful woman and was inspired to make a pasta in her honour, in the shape of her belly button. Not all of Bologna's residents are quite so fond of the fat. This is Osteria Moretto, famous as a meeting place for radicals and intellectuals, and there's not a tourist in sight. Though, according to writer Franco Berardi, that doesn't mean they're not welcome.
The foreigners are not perceived like tourists, but people who have something exciting to tell.
Is Bologna a place where more analyzing goes on?
It used to be. My fear is that Bologna is getting more and more fat, less and less learned.
It certainly is a town of conspicuous consumption. Curious when you remember that the Bolognese tend to vote for what used to be the Communist Party.
Although Bologna's been communist for 40 years, it's not a drab, bleak communism. This is a rich town and people here enjoy a high standard of living. If you come, you can have a share of it, but at a price.
An aperitif will slip down for a cool £4, and a good but moderate meal costs at least 20. But life is good here. Even other Italians are discovering Bologna. It's partly due to this man, actor Gianni Covina. He's become a sort of Italian Inspector Morse with his TV detective series based in Bologna. Gianni has brought me to see the traditional Bolognese trotting races invented here in 1894. And rain doesn't stop play. You can enjoy a meal here and talk over the latest form. Not that easy for us because, like most Bolognese in this untouristy town, Gianni doesn't speak English. So we're muddling through in French.
Let's see if Gianni knows anything about the form tonight, because it's the Grand Prix.
Qu'est-ce qu'on doit choisir ici?
On fait comme ça, regarde, Patrick.
And we've got to win some money.
C'est pas difficile.
Gianni, we've got to win. On doit gagner de la monnaie, de l'argent.
Si, si.
Aveugle.
And they're off. Last. I suppose if I want to live like an Italian, I'll have to lose like an Italian. With a gesture.
So if you fancy behaving like the Bolognese for a few days, then this month is cheap. A flight at the moment is just £149 return. A three-star hotel would cost around £60 for a double room. A two-centre package with two nights in Venice and three nights in Bologna costs £403 from the middle of September. An evening at the Arcoveggio trotting races is £2.50, and a meal in the restaurant is £15, although it could, of course, cost you a lot more if you like a flutter. Finally, handmade tortellini is £5 per kilo if you want a very big bowl of Bologna's favourite pasta. The latest winner of our competition.
San Francisco offers him that opportunity. So he went on our behalf to discover just what it is that gives this city its easygoing and inviting quality.
I had never been in an earthquake, so I didn't even have a frame of reference to know what was going on. The ground just started undulating, kind of like if you imagine like jello.
Cab drivers, they don't change any place you go. Always got a story, always got an opinion.
Were you frightened? Did you panic?
Well, I practically wet my pants. I was so scared. It really was a shock to my system.
Listen, I understand how you feel. You always wanted to come to San Francisco ever since you first saw Columbo and Dirty Harry and what's that other one? What's Up, Doc? You had this idea that the city is a West Coast paradise, and even though you know there's going to be another earthquake here sometime, you know it's never going to happen to you. So what's the real story about San Francisco? Well,
the truth is, it's all true. In just a few square miles, this is a town that lives up to its hype. Though like everywhere else, it's not just the sights that make the city. It's the people who live here. In the 50s, it was Kerouac and Ginsberg, the Beat Generation writers who hung out in the coffee bars and bookstores down in North Beach. And this isn't just any church. It's the church where Marilyn Monroe married Joe DiMaggio. You see, North Beach was that kind of place. And today, the streets still have an air of creativity. Though like any beatnik paperback, it's tended to get a little rough around the edges.
Of course, Italians might argue the point because North Beach has traditionally been their neighborhood. And you'd be amazed to see who's making pizzas around here.
You mean that the one and only Francis Ford Coppola, who created The Godfather, Apocalypse Now, Finian's Rainbow, You're a Big Boy Now, The Conversation, Rumblefish, amongst many others, is making pizzas here in San Francisco?
Yes, I have this side job I've had for years. This thought I've been, covered up a little
bit. And this is Tommaso's. Right. I understand this is, you're exclusive to here. Do you think that San Francisco is a cultural center for life in our world?
Well, it's one of those neighborhoods, you know, that you think of like, the Village, or sort of was the traditional bohemian neighborhood where there was artists, and of course there was important poetry movement. So it's always had those traditions, and they still go on in some form.
I wonder what's better, eating pizza or going to the movies. I guess we have to eat pizza first.
San Francisco is, of course, the perfect place to make a movie. It looks beautiful, it's small, and when you're finished work, there's 2,500 restaurants to choose from. Or else you can just wander around and see if you can spot your favorite movie location. Remember 1967? Well, this is it. Haight-Ashbury, a slightly more subdued setting compared to the old days of the Summer of Love. But you know, some people still keep the old philosophy going. I mean, in a hotel like this, you're in San Francisco before you even leave your room. And downstairs, Sammy Sunchild will tell you that this place is not just the bed and breakfast. It's part of the global village, an eco-bazaar.
Listen, if it can't happen in San Francisco and in the Haight-Ashbury, it's not going to happen. I mean, we are the place, and I am absolutely committed to keeping this place alive for the year 2067 and the people who are alive then, and keeping this historic building where the Summer of Love actually happened, keeping this alive for people, because the whole tide of history came right through where you and I are sitting right now. And I want your children and grandchildren, their friends, to be able to come here too.
Back in the city center, the shops and bustle around Union Square make Haight-Ashbury seem a distant place. The grand hotels are the 90s glamour of this city, their glass elevators showing off 49 million square feet of prime downtown office space. Doing your own thing is what San Francisco's all about. And no one seems to mind that you can walk into a storefront church and see the congregation making a saint of the jazz musician John Coltrane, while the Reverend leads the service in a swinging rendition of A Love Supreme. It just goes to show that freedom is the real religion here, and that this bridge behind me really is a golden gateway, not only to one of the loveliest cities in America, but to a way of life and an attitude of mind that really is unique.
If coffee shops and an easygoing...
One of the first to make its mark on the long... ...list is Buenos Aires. Australian novelist Kathy Lett flew to the Argentinian capital, which sits at the gateway to the South American Pampas at the mouth of the River Plate, where it flows into the South Atlantic. Kathy's interest in matters sensual was aroused in a city where flirting has been turned into a dance called the tango, and whose inhabitants are totally uninhibited about the bare necessities of life and death.
Buenos Aires. My motto for the trip? Don't mention the war. But actually, these days, no one here seems to give a Falklands about it. They call this the Paris of South America. Here you'll find classic architecture, romance, a cafe society with insomnia, and taxis licensed to drive you, well, anywhere they want, really.
It's left there. I think it's left there. Driver.
But the people of Buenos Aires are troubled. They've got three times as many shrinks per head of population as neurotic New York. Here, it seems, they're only happy if they're on their backs stripping off their emotional undies. We're talking Angst City.
So, Doctor, how do I go about finding out how Argentines tick?
Well, I can say that the best place to understand our country, our city, is to go to Recoleta. That is a place near the cemetery. And you have death and sex.
You haven't lived until you've died in Buenos Aires. The Recoleta Cemetery, dead center of town, and a whole neighborhood revolves around it.
Argentines stroll around as if it's the local park, communing with their wealthy ex-compatriots, the ones who finally found tax relief. It's even the last resort of Evita herself. But for the people of Buenos Aires, death is also an aphrodisiac. These are the telos. They're hotel rooms you rent by the hour. These may look like normal beds, but they're more like stationary taxis with a meter running from the moment you check in. If the telos aren't enough to satisfy your appetite, the restaurants just the other side of Death Village certainly will. The Recoleta has the best posh nosh in town, but dining out in Buenos Aires is definitely not for the faint-hearted.
Argentines are particularly fond of animals, especially in the past tense.
The herd sizzling nicely here includes goat, suckling pig, and as many bits of cow as you can think of. And some you probably won't want to.
What do you say if a vegetarian comes to your restaurant?
Vegetarians? Here? Mm. No, vegetarians we don't need here.
You put them on the barbecue? Yeah.
They eat so much meat here, you wouldn't be surprised to see someone ordering the waiter. But it's not just their obsession with sex, death and meat which explains the Buenos Aires psyche. I blame this bloke too. Carlos Gardel's been dead for 60 years, but is still worshipped as the crooner who gave the world the tango. This was a man fluent in body language. You'll get a tourist version of the tango in most nightclubs and hotels. But the real McCoy is only found in downtown tangerias. First danced by Buenos Aires immigrants a century ago, it's the vertical expression of horizontal desire. Hips which pass in the night. In Buenos Aires today, the authentic dance may be passing its amuse-by date. But there are still schools where you can get to grips with the essentials. For the 13 million inhabitants of Angst City, the word sleep isn't in the vocabulary. In the small hours, cafe society moves into gear on an intravenous drip of caffeine. And Buenos Aires woman is out husband hunting. The nightly safari takes place in the Recoleta, the place to see and be seen. My Argentine friend Christina's given me a running commentary on the prospective prey.
Look at this one.
Okay,
now. You can see very, very much alike. You can see that's so much alike.
But is he husband material?
Yes. I mean, it's the person you expect to find here.
It's cruelty to dumb animals, really. I tried but couldn't compete. For Buenos Aires woman, it's every man for herself.
If you want to tango till you drop, then this might be the short break for you. Flight-only prices to Buenos Aires currently start at around £693 return from support team in Europe and Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi. Frank set his video and donned his West Brom away kit for a heart-thumping trip.
Italy. The only place in the world where it's possible to look cool on a scooter. So, I'm in Milan and this is the mighty San Siro Stadium. This time Sunday afternoon, I'll be here watching Milan versus Lazio. The original stadium was built in the 1950s, but after a massive overhaul for the 1990 World Cup, it now holds 83,000 people and looks like something out of Star Trek. Phew, my kind of tourist attraction. Of course, the San Siro isn't the only place of worship in Milan. like a nice church. This is the Duomo, the third biggest cathedral in the world. And if you can hear a sort of a strange squawking, squelching noise, that's what happens when you try to walk through pigeons and look into camera at the same time. OK, it's got some interesting architecture. When I was walking through the Galleria, Milan's famous old shopping arcade, I came across their own version of the bullring. The locals believe if you grind your heel into the right bit of old Taurus here, you get to make a wish. Now that is the look of someone with the worst job in the world. Oh, wow! It's a magic security pass! Right, so here we are at Milanello, the AC Milan training camp, yeah? Behind me is arguably the greatest club side in the world, worth millions of pounds, having what they call a training session, what we used to call headers and fancy kicks when I was at school. I'm hiding here because obviously if they see this shirt, they'll be quaking in their boots, and I don't want to put them off their stroke. But I want to see if I can get a bit closer. I must remember to tell old Taurus about this. Right, now this is Ruud Gullit on his way here, one of the most famous footballers in the whole world. You probably recognise the shirt instantly, right? Hello.
Hello. What is this?
Photograph. Oh. Can I have a quick snap? I wanted to get my photo taken with some of the star players. It's easy enough to recognise Ruud, what with his dreadlocks and all, but in some cases, I think I might have slipped up. And Taurus granted me two other wishes. One, to be that stupid bloke who stands at the bat when people are being interviewed. And secondly, to get some fashion advice from one of the trendiest players in football.
Yeah, it's okay, it's okay.
Would it go with
the only
hair?
Thing bad is this, not because of the sponsor, but no, it has no sense, you know, this white, you know.
Oh, right. But they sell very nice cars, I understand.
Yeah, that is possible, you know, but it doesn't fit with the colours, you know.
Oh, God, that's
the only
very,
bad thing.
They'll be very upset to know that you
said. Yeah,
that,
I can't, can't help it, but.
Anyway, I better keep you in the right.
But what
team,
I like more, you know,
oh, yeah.
is this.
This?
Yeah,
like
it's
this.
it's not printed, you know, but it's stitched.
Yeah,
yeah.
Now that's
okay.
Oh, I like the start, and we've got a little thrush on these.
Yeah, but this is okay.
This
is very nice.
So, with Ruud's sartorial advice still ringing in my ears, I set off for the Via Monte Napoleone, the very heartland of fashionable Milan, to check out the autumn collection of Gianni Versace.
Hey, looking good. What a nice place.
Ooh, it was like finding yourself in a Grattan's catalogue.
Nice. Self-basting, apparently.
I wonder if they'd embroider me a thrush on this. What do you think?
I like it.
Right, so I've done a bit of designer shopping. I've been drawn into Milan's consumer society, and I spent 70 quid on this. Right, so let's just see if it works, shall we? Bargain. Now, the Italian games are played on Sunday, but it was Saturday afternoon and I had to have my football fix. That's why I paid a visit to the Osteria del Paloni, a football bar in Milan's Canal District. It was a very impressive place, just missing one vital ingredient. I don't know what it is, but I always feel at home on a towpath. This is a very romantic area, popular with artists and art collectors. In fact, the canals themselves were designed by Leonardo, presumably before he started playing for Brazil.
West Norwich Albion 1, Groups for Town 1. In Division 2, Bournemouth 1, Chester City.
In the evening, I headed for La Scala, home of Italian opera, obviously an occasion which called for my more formal evening wear. When it's a big opening night, I always like to go for the home kit, a little bit more sober than the green and yellow. Oh, and I decided to take Ruud's advice about the sponsor's logo. up in the moat. It was a goalless first half, but just watching the Italian crowd was an experience in itself. Right, well, it's half time and I've already learnt a few Italian gestures, right? This means good, this means very good, and I don't know what this means, but I think it's something to do with the referee. The second half started off slowly, but it gave me some time for a bit of cultural exchange. And then it was Goal City! I thought it was going to be another one-all draw, just like the Albion. But we came back and we won, thanks to my old football buddy and fashion advisor, Ruud Hollit. Bless him. West Bromwich, please, mate.
Ah, West Bromwich. That one-all draw with Grimsby Town was a bit disappointing.
Football weekends are available to both Rome and Milan for the duration of the season. A trip including flights, a match ticket and a three-star hotel is... As Paddy found out, the frightening efficiency means that you have to look a little harder to find the Orient you might have expected.
The gateway to the Far East. An island city of 3 million people. No bigger than the Isle of Wight. The streets are straight out of Manhattan. The shopping opportunities, legendary. The hotels, space age, air-conditioned, and vast. It's a far cry from the colonial outpost you'd have found here just a generation ago.
High-rise, high-tech, high-flying. That's how Singapore is determined to be seen today. Some would say the result is more far west than far east. And I'm wondering if there's anything left here of the old Orient at all.
They do still play cricket on the Padang, one of the few green spaces that remains in the city centre. But the Raffles Hotel, that other famous reminder of Singapore's past, is dwarfed by skyscrapers. The pace of development has also threatened to engulf Singapore's old Chinatown. In this tiny enclave, hemmed in by the new business district, Sin Kee is the last bookbinder plying his trade on the street. He would have been forced out in the 1980s if Singapore hadn't had a change of heart.
The government then woke up and decided, hey, wait, stop all this tearing down of the old. Maybe there's a dollar that can be made of it. And that district in Chinatown, fortunately for us, hadn't been torn down yet.
You see, journalist Mary Lee explained that a renovation program is underway.
Things like that.
But in a city obsessed with progress, the old way of life is unlikely to be saved.
The old style was part of one's past, and it no longer is, so one's past is gone.
But it's being recreated here on the streets.
Yes, but only cosmetically, because the trades, the people, are all different. I mean, it's all yuppie businesses now.
In the new Chinatown, aging bookbinders are out. Slick shops and offices and smart restaurants are in. Far from living in its shadow, the place seems set to become a trendy extension of Singapore's towering financial centre. My quest to find something more of the authentic Orient continued. Changi Port,
10 miles east of the city. From here, it's a short trip by bumboat to Pulau Ubin, one of the islands off Singapore's coast. As Singapore develops, Pulau Ubin has been left behind. Here, you'll still find a kampong, the Malay word for village.
This is probably the last traditional Malay village that is inhabited. All the others have gone.
There are lots of different species of birds and
trees. Raj Rajaturai, a Singaporean Tamil, is a nature guide on the island. He fears it won't be long before the prospect of development looms here too.
In the Malay village, we're down to probably the last 60-odd people left on the island. It's about 600 plus. The population declines every year.
Does that sadden you?
Yes, it does, because you really need a little part of Singapore to remain as it is, as a reminder at least to the younger generation of where we've come from.
The reality is most of the old Singapore has gone forever, and what's left is vanishing fast. In its place is a safe, sanitized version of the Far East. But this new Singapore is attracting 6 million visitors a year. The big draw today, theme parks. They're pulling in families in ever-growing numbers, and 7 out of 10 visitors now come from the Far East itself. Ironically, they've built a replica Asian village here, a pristine recreation of the Orient that's disappearing. But whatever you think of the new Singapore, one reason for refueling here is as good as it ever was. This is one of the island's hawker centres. The people who serve the food used to cook on street corners until the government banned the practice and made them all operate under one roof.
Well, we prefer here, it's much better.
Do you?
Better, because here, permanent places. Everything, cleanliness, hygiene, everything we have here.
The result is an exciting, exotic fast food supermarket where you bag yourself a table and order from any stall you like.
Very big. How much is that going to cost me if I want to eat that?
At last, in this modern, very Western city, I'd managed to find a slice of the old Orient at its best.
Say the words French Connection and you think of Marseille. Don't look now and you think of Venice. For some parts, Kowloon City, Hong Kong Island, the outlying islands and the new territories connected to the mainland. Although no one is quite sure what will happen after 1997 when the Chinese take over, Alan found out what is making Hong Kong a top tourist draw.
Do you know what? That man gave us his business card just as soon as we'd finished filming. But that's Hong Kong for you. Land of contradictions. And this week, land of travel agents. And according to the agent's extensive blurb, this Victoria Peak tram is the most popular attraction. I would have found it more attractive if my breakfast had digested properly.
I'm with a whole load of travel agents who are checking out Hong Kong, and I've come to check out them, so I suppose you could say I'm playing Chinese checkers. Wah, wah. They spend a lot of their time going to hotel rooms, checking out shower caps, hair dryers, room sizes, and last night they spent a lot of time checking out the bar. What a racket!
And there's the hotel just down there. Where? Just in between. Oh, yeah!
They all look the same from up here.
Yeah.
But where's our lunch to take to anyway?
See ya! I wanted to be alone. But that's pretty difficult here. There are over 6 million people crammed into an area just a wee bit bigger than Surrey. The only difference being that Surrey has less dried fish. But at least here, I felt as if I was in the real Hong Kong. The real people, the real vegetables, the real spare ribs.
In Chinese, Wine Gong means fragrant harbour. That's because there's a harbour here. and it's quite fragrant. It's also absolutely heaving, it's unreal. It's like being on the set of a movie the entire time.
Action, Chile!
Gosh, that was a neat link. Because I did actually stumble onto a movie set. Mind you, with about 200 films being shot each year, it's quite hard not to. I Want to Live is the title. Sylvia Cheung is the star. Sylvia is a great actress, but she's not so hot at Kung Fu.
Cut.
Now I'll teach you how to fight. The first punch. That's right.
This guy, however, is.
Hey! Wait, wait!
Anthony okay. Carpio is a top stunt coordinator.
Now I'll teach you how to kick. The first kick.
He thinks I could be very big in Kung Fu movies.
Hey! Wait, hey! Wait, wait!
Okay.
Great pecs, eh? Mine, I mean. Meanwhile, the travel agents were taking their hotel inspections far too seriously, I felt. They kept snapping my facilities at all hours of the night. I mean, do I look like a well-stocked minibar? No Hong Kong hostelry was safe from their probing.
How many rooms does the Comrade have?
It's 513 rooms.
Wonderful.
Did you say the minibar was free?
The coffee tea maker. Yeah, we have complimentary coffee tea making machine there.
That one.
Was there any extra question that you need to ask after the site inspection?
I think I've covered most of the points, and that's great.
On to the next sequence, please.
You never think I'm eccentric. They won't move. They just think I'm a mad person who's come off the street with a xylophone.
Shopping. Serious shopping. What we really came to Hong Kong for. The opportunity to purchase quality Oriental tat at knockdown prices. And the chance for a bit of lovely travel agent slash presenter bonding. Lovely t-shirt. Not.
If you can't find anything that takes your fancy at the market, then you could come to a bespoke tailor. And I've come today to the most famous one in all of Hong Kong, Sam's. And this is actually your real Sam.
You're right, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
And, Sam, anyone who's anyone has been to your shop and had something made, haven't they?
Yes,
Mrs. Thatcher,
sir.
Prince Charles, Fergie, Janet Jackson, David Bowie.
Right. Even you, sir.
Even me.
Right,
thank
sir.
You.
Can I measure you, sir, now?
Yes, you can.
Sure, sir.
I want something traditional.
Yes, sir, I understand, sir.
And, Fergie, what was her sort of measurements?
Well, that's confidential, sir.
All right.
38 and a half chest.
Is that all?
Yeah, you're slim. You
oh, know, I thought it was
you're
Fergie there,
yeah,
sorry.
Yeah, 33 and a half.
How long will it take?
Well, it'll be next scene.
Wong Tai Sin is one of the busiest Taoist temples in Kowloon. In the midst of this concrete jungle, the burghers of Hong Kong light incense and lay offerings of fruit and roast chicken before their gods. If it's Tuesday, it must be the New Territories. And by now, I was becoming dangerously familiarised.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Alan, and I'm your official tour guide for this morning's trip to the New Hong Kong Territories. That's the New Hong Kong Territories. Thank you. Now, the New Hong Kong...
Little known fact. More than 70% of Hong Kong is countryside, and there are lots of mountains too. There you go. A travel agent told me to say that.
OK, attention, everybody. Here we are in the Tai Mo Shan Country Park viewpoint. You can see there, that's down there is our hotel on Hong Kong Island. And over just behind the hotel is Stonecutters Island, which isn't actually an island anymore because all the water's been reclaimed. Beautiful, beautiful vista.
Hello, how are you?
I bumped into these chaps and they told me where it might be less misty. The only thing was, I'd have to make my own way. At the last count, there were 235 islands around Hong Kong, and that means a lot of beaches. A lot of beautiful beaches. A lot of beautiful shark-infested beaches. But fear not, this one's got a shark net. It is possible to practice safe swimming. Oh, crikey.
I wasn't totally convinced by the shark net, so I've found some friends. And this is Edwin over here, who is a shark killer.
Hi.
Hi, Edwin. He's looking a wee bit nervous. And this is Steve Chan. Hello, Steve. How do you do?
Very nice to meet you.
You too. Now, you're a shark expert, aren't you?
Yes.
But there's been a lot of trouble with sharks in Hong Kong recently.
Serious trouble in Hong Kong.
How many people have been eaten?
Within 2 weeks' time, 3 people already
kill.
Three people have been killed, crikey.
Yes.
But aren't there shark nets on most of the beaches?
No, only three in Hong Kong.
Wow, and there's loads of beaches, aren't there?
Definitely.
Gosh, so the moral of the story is, if you go swimming on a beach in Hong Kong, make sure there is a shark net. Thank you.
The good news is that the Hong Kong government promised shark nets for all swimming beaches by next year. Not so good for the sharks, though. By the time I'd cycled back to Hong Kong Island, all my travel agent chums were off out on the town. No doubt getting familiar with the contents of a cocktail shaker at some exotic nightery. I plumped for another indigenous evening. Hong Kong is at its best by night, and I think there's no better place than Temple Street Market. Later, down by the fragrant harbour, I bumped into some familiar faces.
How many rooms in the Conrad?
Well, it's the last night here in Hong Kong. All the travel agents having a well-deserved little drink. They've shopped till they've dropped. They've probed and prized many, many hotel rooms. They've soaked up the culture, and it's goodbye from Hong Kong.
We caroused until the second cock, and I just had time for one last bowl of chicken noodles before the Airbus back to Blighty.
Lingtai, sik mien! Sik yun ye juk jung sik mien!
Huh? Hey! Hey,
what?
Joy!
What?
Hey!
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 Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey! Hey!
If you still fancy dangling your toes on a great shark hunt, direct flights to Hong Kong International Airport. Huntman's first challenge was getting his bite to